it's, you know, it's been godly. And, you know, just nice to see everybody. I can tell Adjuns are working along there, and that's all great stuff. Is there anyone that has a ballot? If you do, hold it up in the air. And, uh-oh, somebody turned me off. Turn me back on. There we go. If you have a ballot, please hold it. They didn't want me to say anything about ballots. That's what it was. Hold it up in the air, and somebody will come by and pick it up real quickly. I see none, so I guess we're okay. Those need to be turned in now. Okay. Anything after right now is null and void. Okay. There are some cherry tomatoes out on the little bench on the vestibule. Did you put any of what are they called? They're black cherry. Did you put any of those in here? There are some of those cherry tomatoes that are dark, and they're called black cherry. And they're sweet. They all taste good. But anyway, there you go. Charlie, you want to make an announcement regarding our the whole thing with regards to the yard sale?
Yard sale, yes. Thank the Lord, He blessed us. We made over $1,200. I want to thank everybody. I'm not going to name names because I'll miss somebody and I don't want to do that. So I want to say thank you for those that brought stuff to donate. Thank you for those that helped with the yard sale, and so we're just carrying stuff throughout the week. But he was down there yesterday, and thank you for the donation that people made. After the service, you're more than welcome to go down there, go through the stuff, take what you want. Whatever's left is going to be going through the mission. We'll probably give them a call, see if they'll come after it. If not, we'll truck it to them. But again, after the service, help yourself to go down there and look, see if there's anything there. But again, thank you.
Okay. Do you have any other? Well, there shouldn't be any other questions. That's pretty explanatory. So thank you very much for everybody that took part in that and the work that was involved. Anything regarding the cleanup that we want to do, we need, because we need to move tables and stuff, right?
Yes.
Okay. We'll work on those as time permits. We'll take care of all that. But that'll all be part of that cleanup. You can help. Give Charlie a call. Or Denise, can we do that? Or Denise, call Charlie, call him at 4:30, and then that way we can know what we're doing, and you know, as far as things go, and we'll get everything cleaned up. Other announcements: there are a couple other programs that will be restarting. The year is our fiscal year is coming to an end, and our new fiscal year is starting. So there are men's groups, discipleship group. Go ahead.
Now, the men's discipleship group will start back on September the 10th.
Right, it starts on the 10th. And our Pioneer Kids, and it starts
13th.
The first Wednesday, next Wednesday.
13th.
The 13th.
September.
And your ladies' group starts when?
The 11th. September
the 11th.
So everything's
okay.
That week.
All right, so, okay, I get that in my head now. Okay, so the week of the 10th, the 11th, and the 13th, put them on your calendars now so that you can be here and be a part of that. Other announcements that I may have missed. Somebody raise your hand and wave it. What is it?
There is a sign-up sheet in the back for Pioneer Club for the meals for the kids on Wednesday night.
Yes, Pioneer Club sign-up sheet for meals. And if you have questions regarding that, see Eileen, but sign that up and plan for about 300 or less. All right. I think all the other announcements are in your bulletin. The only other announcement that I want to make is this is going to be the last Sunday that I will be opening our services as I am right now. This is the last time that I will be doing this. I will be taking part in the services. Don't get excited. But it's about some time that someone else take over this position right now with having announcements and asking for prayer requests and things of that nature. Okay? So if you are interested in doing that, see me and I will fill you in, but I will not be up here to open services from after today, okay? By way of prayer request, there's a couple of additions that we have. We had mentioned that Shirley McDaniel fell and broke her hip. She broke her femur, but still needs to be remembered in prayers. And the family of Mike Reiner, if you would put that family, Mike Reiner passed away. Are there other prayer requests that we have not been given or I'm not aware of? I think our prayer list is pretty extensive, and it's nice to know that our church family reaches as far as it does. All right, seeing no other requests, would you please stand? And Floyd will have our opening prayer, and then as Sarah comes to lead our time of singing together.
Our Father in heaven, we come to you this day as we are gathered in this place of worship. We thank you for this, and we thank you for the weather we've had, that many times we look around the world and see many things going on, that fires and destruction and floods, and a lot of times don't appreciate what we have and how we've been blessed. We thank you for that. Thank God each one of us that are here this morning that have certain things on our mind that maybe others are not aware of, that you would comfort us and guide us and strengthen each one of us as we go through our daily walk of life, not knowing what the person, people around us may be going through, that help us to look out in the community, and if we see somebody or a way that we can help out, encourage us to just take care of those around us and give a helping hand where we can. We do thank you for those that are willing to step up and do things here in this church that as different needs come up, we need somebody to, at this time has been mentioned, with regard to opening the service, that we look to you and ask that you would have that person step forward and help us out, or those people step forward. We do thank you for those in this community that are willing to help out and give and take care of those around us, and the many things that you've done for each one of us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Bibles with you, I'd like for you to turn to Luke chapter 22. If you would do that as well, please. We're going to be using that as our scripture reference this morning. I'm going to start reading in verse 7, and then I'm going to ask you to follow along, and I'll give you some instructions with your your packets in just a moment. Please make sure they are both open, both parts. Verse 7, then came the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, go and make preparation for us to eat the Passover. Where did you want us to prepare for it? They asked. He replied, as you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters. And say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, all furnished. Make preparations there. They left, Peter and Jonah, Peter and Jonah. They left and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. These are the verses that are critical for our time of communion this morning. When the hour came, this is starting in verse 14. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. Verse 17, after taking the cup, and I'd like for you to take it in hand if you would please. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Pray with me. Father in heaven, we thank you for the emblems that are here. And now we ask your blessing to be upon this fruit of the vine, the grape juice that we have. And may we partake of this, remembering the blood that was spilled for our sins. You would now please take of the juice. Verse 19. And he took bread. And if you would, please take your wafer and hold it in hand. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Heavenly Father, we take the loaf now, and we remember that this is representative of your body that was slain for us. The juice and the wafer combined are our communion service that we take in remembrance of your sacrifice, of your love, and for the hope that it holds for us. Please take of this wafer at this time. This story continues in the 22nd chapter of Luke. But the purpose of our communion service is to remember that the center part, it's okay, go ahead, the central part of our service and our worship together. Please don't forget these emblems. Please don't just take them and slough it off. They are a very important part of our time and our worship together.
very blessed people. We're gearing back up for the fall. August is our 1 month where it's a little bit slower. I was thinking about it. I was like, our schedule goes September to July. It slows down a little bit in August and went back to it in September. So we have the men's discipleship group, the ladies' discipleship groups, Pioneer Club for the kids. Please participate. These things will help you in your walk with God, and they help everybody participate. Really true what they do. So please remember those things if you would. And let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you are holy, 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 and thank you that you love us, and thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die in our place. A God, that we can be with you. God, please forgive us, God, of our sins. Fill us and lead us, God, with your Holy Spirit. God, please open our hearts, God, to you and your word and your spirit, God, today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I shared this, but this is the first message that I will be sharing twice, and there's a reason, okay? So this is the one message so far that I have shared once before. But we are winding down our series in Essentials Unity, in Opinions Liberty, and in All Things Love. And so the title of this message is In All Things Love. Every week we study the Word of God, it's a new adventure. The Bible is living and active. It is truly profound what we can learn if we humble ourselves before Him and allow God to speak to us through His Holy Spirit and through His Word and then apply it to our lives. I learned a lot of things in studying this topic of love, going back to the beginning. Most of them are great and on a higher plane. A couple of them are base and as you study the Greek language, but still need to be mentioned for us to be able to understand what is love, okay? But the greatest discovery to me is one that is supernatural. Yes, that's right. There's one type of love that is actually supernatural. I believe it truly comes from God. And so when we define love or when we understand love, we need to understand what God is telling us to do specifically, right? And so that's why we need to do a study of love. What is it that God is commanding us to do? Jesus commanded us in John 15, 12, "This is my commandment, that you love one another." Well, what does he mean? What does it mean, love? We have a general concept, but what is he talking about there? "This is my commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you." So the first point we'll look at today is we must ask the question, what is love? Now, the Hebrew language wasn't anywhere near as descriptive as the Greek language, often putting a ton of concepts into just one word. An example of this is the word ahava, A-H-A-V-A, okay, is their one word that they have for love in the Hebrew language. Now, Strong's dictionary defines ahava as to have affection for or to love. Now, all the types of love were wrapped up into just this one word, and that would be very confusing, right, because there are different types of love. I'm very thankful that Jesus was born in a time where we have far more descriptive language than that of Greek. Through God's providence and helping us to understand Him in a much clearer way, instead of just in a more vague way in the Old Testament, God has been revealing more and more about Himself, His plan, and His kingdom over time. But in large portion, He does that today, yes, through His Word, yes, through His Holy Spirit, but also through language. When you study language specifically, we come to a far greater understanding of what the Scriptures are actually saying to us. It was very important for the Bible to be written in Greek because it is such a deep and specific and descriptive language. Now, that being said, let's look at the word that the Greeks used for love. In other words, the different types of love that the Greeks used. Now, according from their perspective, so that's where we'll start. There are at least seven different words for the word love. At least seven different words. Now, the first one is storge. Storge, okay? That's how it's pronounced. It's spelled S-T-O-R-G-E, okay? This is a type of empathy. This is a family type of love. Loving affection, a tenderness type of love. This is the type of love that a parent has for their child, right? And then hopefully, prayerfully, over time, that a child also has for their parent. Okay? Although in the positive form of this word, it's not used by itself because I haven't been invented yet in the Old Testament, the concept can be seen in Exodus chapter 20 and verse 12. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be prolonged in the land which the Lord your God gives you. We had an opportunity to spend a day and a half with my mom and dad and with my grandmother. And it was very precious to see my mom lead my grandmother, who's 93, lead her around and be there for her, comfort her, and make sure that she was able to go where she needed to go and different things. But that's the type of love. And I know my grandmother had that type of love, still does, have that type of love for mom. Other examples of this positive form could be found in Noah and his family, Mary and Martha and Lazarus. The positive form of the word is used in combination with another positive type of love that we'll share here in a little while. Now, Greek is very descriptive, and the negative form of this word is used in two places in the scripture. Romans chapter 1, verse 31, it says this, referring to the godless. They have no understanding, they have no fidelity, they have no love. The godless have no love for their family. Wow. No fidelity, no love, no mercy. And again, referring to the future, this is 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 4. Well, this is when it's written, written to the future. Now it's referring partly to the time in which we're living. In the last days, difficult times will come. For men will be lovers of self, lovers of money, boastful, arrogant, revilers, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, unloving. They will not love their own family. Irreconcilable, malicious gossips, without self-control, brutal, haters of good, treacherous, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. So that's the first type of love, the storge, which is a family empathy type of love, okay? All right, so the next one is pragma. And honestly, pragma is the most boring of all the different types of love. Now, this is choosing to love for practical reasons alone. All right, out of duty, out of shared goals. This was likely practiced in the Middle Ages, or sometimes early in early America, out of for very practical reasons. This to me, by all the different types of love, this is the most boring of them all. Although the word is not mentioned, this type of love, this type of love is seen in the scriptures when a king would marry the daughter of another king in order to have peace between the two kingdoms, right? It was simply for practical reasons, that was it, okay? Saul giving his daughter Michal to whoever defeated Goliath would also fit into this category as well. Now, the third type of love, according to the Greek language, is ludus, L-U-D-U-S. Now, this is the playful, focused on fun, the flirting, uncommitted type of love. This is a middle school crush type of love, okay? Of all the concepts of love, this is the most difficult to be found in the scriptures. But I do believe you can see it with Jacob and Rachel, and Isaac and Rebecca, and yes, some with Song of Solomon. But there has to also be other types of love affiliated with this one in order for it to be healthy. Okay? So, this is, again, and this one, if it's not accompanied by more than just eros, can be extremely destructive. So, the next one is eros. E-R-O-S. Now, eros is the romantic type of love. This is the physical attraction type of love. This is the passionate, but not, if not accompanied by the higher forms of love, is to me the second most dangerous of them all. If combined with ludus, it is not the higher form, and not other higher forms of love, it's extremely dangerous. It is only in Christian marriage that all the types of love are fully experienced and they honor God. I want to say that again. It's only in Christian marriage that all the types of love can be experienced. The concept is definitely in Scripture in both Song of Solomon and also in Proverbs as well. This is the type of love the Scriptures tell us not to awaken until we're married. That's from Song of Solomon. Now, the next one is this. Philautia, and that is love of self. Love of self. It's P-H-I-L-A-U-T-I-A. Love of self. Now, this category can be extremely unhealthy and the most dangerous of them all if a person's pride and ego are like King Saul or Demas or Diotrephes, or they just think that they're everything. All right, they think they don't have to answer to anybody. That's when they get themselves into trouble, okay? Or if this person is truly humble and has a healthy view of themselves and follows Christ's example, this one actually can be good. So examples of the good in this would be John the Apostle, Peter, James, the Apostle Paul. They were mature in the faith, they had a healthy view of themselves, and they could love God and love others, and it was a good thing. So the family type of love, is there's three of them that we are commanded in the scriptures to have within the church, okay, within the family of God. So the first one is the storge. We're commanded to have a family type of love for one another. We're commanded to have it. The next one is this. We're commanded to have this second one. Philou. Now, this is the brotherly, friend, kindness type of love. It also, this is, again, one of the three types that we're commanded in the scriptures to have one for another within the Lord's church. Philou refers to a brotherly type of love and is most often expressed in a very close friendship. Brooke, I hope you're okay that I say this. But Brooke and Bob are really good friends. And they took me out this past, a week ago, to encouragement. And you can tell that those two guys, they love the Lord, but they love one another. They're very close friends. But you guys are very close friends, right? You've been close friends since high school. Been close friends since high school. And so they're very close, brotherly. They have a very close brotherly friendship. That's what this is referring to. This is the type of thing it's referring to. So best friends will display this generous and affectionate type of love for each other, and they seek to encourage one another and to help the other one out. The scriptural account of David and Jonathan falls into this category. Okay, it's an excellent illustration. Now, some try to say that David and Jonathan had the wrong, you know, they try to read stuff in there that's not there. There's nothing unhealthy or unholy in the friendship that David and Jonathan had. Okay? All right, so they had a healthy, God-honoring, brotherly type of love for one another. As after David had finished talking with Saul, Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself. And Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. These two loved each other deeply as brothers. They watched out for and helped to protect one another. And after Jonathan passed, David actually looked after Jonathan's family. This love, in their case, and I believe clearly from the scripture as well, it should surpass biological love. Remember, Jonathan watched out for David. Even though his father was trying to kill him, he tried to protect David every chance that he got. Okay, so his love for his brother, in a sense, David, was even greater than the love for his father because he was trying to honor God and he wanted to watch out for David. So God does want us to love our fellow believer this way. He wants us to love each other as family. He wants us to love each other as brothers. Okay? But also with another type of love that I'll describe in a minute. So, combination of family love and brotherly love. So, interestingly, here's the thing. Interestingly enough, we're never commanded to love God with a brotherly type of love. Isn't that interesting? We're never commanded in the scriptures to love God with a brotherly type of love. Why? Because God's not our brother. He's our creator. We're to love him. We are to revere him. We're to love him in other ways, but we're not commanded to love him as a brother. Now, because God is not a brother, he is God, he is Lord of all. God calls us to a different type of love for him. So since Philou, love involves feelings of warmth and affection towards another person, we do not, this type of love, this brotherly type of love, is not one that's directed to our enemies either, okay? But there is one that is. Okay, so here's the greatest form of them all. Now, this word is agapeo, or agape, okay? So easier form of it is A-G-A-P-E. Now, this is the greatest forms of all the different types of love, okay? It is, now get this, it is unconditional love. We have a tendency as human beings to love those who love us, don't we? We get ourselves in a lot of trouble. We also have a tendency to follow our emotions, too, don't we? And that, too, can get us into a lot of trouble. But we need to love God. God loves us unconditionally. We need to love God unconditionally. And we need to love one another unconditionally.
Agape speaks of the most powerful, the most noble type of love that there is. This is sacrificial love. Agape love means more than a feeling. It is an act of will. Now, if you only spoke to your spouse when you felt like it or when your emotions told you to, what would happen?
I love you, babe.
We get ourselves in a lot of trouble, right? Right? If we only were committed when our feelings felt like it, what would happen? We get in trouble. Big time trouble. Now here's the thing. When we make a commitment before God, we make a commitment to love God unconditionally, but we make a commitment to one another that we're going to love each other unconditionally as well, right? So even though... she would be... anyway, so even... I gotta be careful with this one. All right, so even though we may occasionally, rarely get on each other's nerves, what have we done? We've made a commitment before God, and we've made a commitment to one another, haven't we? Right? It's a commitment. And the same thing needs to be true in the Lord's church as far as loving one another, even when our feelings don't tell us to do so. Because our feelings can be dead wrong. We need to love each other regardless and do what's right. Okay? It's a commitment to God. It's a commitment to one another. Okay? This is the love that God has for his people and that prompted the sacrifice of his only son, Jesus, for our sins. Jesus was agape love personified. Christians are to love one another with agape love. When Jesus said, love one another, by this they'll know that you're my disciples, what is he referring to? It's not all the other definitions of love, it's agape. Love each other unconditionally. By this they'll know that you are my disciples if you unconditionally love one another. Agapeo is the characteristic for the word, the most characteristic word for, or should be, for Christianity. Beautifully, and I believe led by the Holy Spirit, this is the very word that is used in John 17:26, which is the verse that we started with in this series. Okay? So this is the, as Jesus is praying for unity, this is John 17:26, as Jesus was praying for unity, he says this, "And I have made your name known to them, and will make it known, so that the love, the unconditional love, which you loved me, with which you love me, may be in them and I in them." So, Father God, you unconditionally love me. And I want them to know your unconditional love. Okay? All right? So, God commands us to have agape love towards one another. This includes those personalities with whom our personalities will honestly clash. Those who hurt us. Those who treat us badly. Even those who are hostile to our faith, we are to unconditionally love them. In time, as we follow God's example of agape love, we can love even our enemies unconditionally. We may even begin to experience eventually over time, philia, which is brotherly type of love, through the Holy Spirit eventually for them, as we look at them through God's eyes, not our own. Now, point number two, in studying this topic of love, the scriptures led me to the interactions between the Lord Jesus and the Apostle Peter. So, to set the background on this, we must remember what Jesus told Peter and the disciples before he was crucified. Now, this is Matthew, and by the way, thank you, John. That's what the rush was for this morning. I had given in the wrong chapter. So we got to figure it out. So this is Matthew chapter 26 and verse 31. Let's start with verse 31. Matthew 26, beginning with verse 31. So it says, "Then Jesus said to them, You will all fall away because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike down the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go ahead of you to Galilee. But Peter said to him, even though all may fall away because of you, I will never fall away. Jesus said to him, truly, I say to you, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Peter said to him, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. All the disciples said the same thing. So, we're going to skip on down. Jesus goes and prays in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus is arrested. Jesus goes before Caiaphas. We're going to skip on down to verse 69 through 75. It says, "So now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him and said, you too were with Jesus the Galilean. But he denied it before them all, saying, I do not know who you're talking about. When he had gone out of the gateway, another servant girl said to him, and said to those who were there, "This man was the Jesus of Nazareth." And again he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." A little later, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Surely you too are one of them, for even the way you talk gets you away." In other words, your accent, "Surely you're from Galilee." Then he began to curse and swear, "I do not know the man." And immediately the rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the word which Jesus had said to him, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and he wept bitterly. He was brokenhearted. He went out and he repented. Godly sorrow leads to repentance. So Jesus is right. Peter did disown him 3 times. Jesus killed on the cross, fulfilling the scriptures that he, as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now let's look ahead. Jesus is risen from the dead. He appears to many by the Sea of Galilee. And however, he takes Peter aside with an extremely important conversation. Okay, so now, he's died, he's rose again, he's going back and talking with his disciples, specifically Peter at this moment. Okay, an extremely important conversation. This is John chapter 21, verse 15. So when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my lambs," was Jesus' instruction. He said to him again the second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Shepherd my sheep." He said to him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said this a third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." Peter had denied Jesus 3 times. Jesus is now restoring him 3 times. Peter had truly repented. Peter is restored. Now that being said, when you study the Greek, there's something far greater going on here. Something far greater. You miss it in the English, but if you study the Greek, it's something far greater. When Jesus asked Peter the first time, "Do you love me?" Jesus is using the word agape. "Peter, do you love me unconditionally?" Peter responds with, "Lord, you know that I love you." And the best that Peter can do is as a brother, as a friend. "Lord, you know I love you as a brother, as a friend." Jesus asked him a second time, "Peter, do you love me?" Agape. "Peter, do you love me unconditionally?" And Peter responds again, "Lord, you know that I love you as a brother, as a friend." Jesus asks a third time, "Do you love me?" But this time he does something different. He too uses the word philo. So he says, in other words, "Peter, do you love me as a brother or as a friend?" Now, why would Jesus do this? I racked my brain over this. Why would this be happening? Honestly, if you study the commentaries on this passage, they are all over the place. They're everywhere. They're all over the place as far as what's going on here. I thought about it, and then it made sense to me. Is Jesus restoring Peter fully? Yes, he is. Okay? But he's also challenging him to grow and to reach his full potential. In effect, he's saying, "Peter, if you're going to grow fully, Peter, you must learn to love unconditionally. You haven't learned that lesson yet. You must learn to love unconditionally. God first, and then your fellow man." In effect, this very soon is what I will be expecting of you, Peter. Peter responds with the best love that he can muster at the time in his own strength. And by the way, 6 of the 7 types of love, I believe, can be accomplished by human effort alone. But one cannot. There's one that cannot be accomplished by human effort. And that's agape. We'll get to that in a little bit, but Peter responds with the best love he can muster at the time in his own strength, the friendship, brotherly type of love. Now, why does Jesus ask a third time and then use the brotherly word here? I thought about it, and the question is, how are Jesus and Peter like brothers? How are Peter and Jesus like brothers? How would they be like brothers, I should say? From this point on, how would they become like brothers? Well, the answer is in their suffering. Jesus is Lord, Jesus is Savior, Jesus is Creator, He's Redeemer. So how could they be like brothers? They were brothers in the suffering that they went through. They both were crucified according, and we know Jesus was on the cross, okay? But according to tradition, according to church history, Peter was also crucified on the cross, and I believe going from memory, he was crucified upside down. Then later, I read this, and I was thrilled to find that it all fit. It all made sense. John 21, verse 18 says this. This is Jesus saying, "Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were younger, you used to gird yourself and walk around wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will gird you and bring you to where you do not want to go." Verse 19 there. Now this, he said, signifying the kind of death that he would glorify God with. In other words, Peter, yes, you are going to be like a brother in suffering. And when he had spoken this, he said to him, "Follow me." What's he saying? "Peter, follow me even to be crucified. Follow God, follow me even to be crucified." Peter knew exactly what Jesus meant regarding being crucified. He knew exactly what he meant. And then what's Peter do? What about John? What's going to happen to John? And Jesus basically tells him, "Well, that's none of your business. You, however, follow me." Now, point number three. Why was Peter unable to match the love that Jesus was asking him to match? And here's the key point at that moment. He couldn't match it at that moment. And the answer is in the scripture. As I studied it deeply, I believe we as humans are capable, again, of all the different types of love except for one. And I believe the Bible proves it over and over and over again. I believe with all my heart and all my soul the scriptures prove this. We are commanded to love agape. We are commanded to love unconditionally. We are commanded to love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, with all of our strength. We are commanded to love God first unconditionally. But it doesn't stop there. Jesus said, "A new commandment I give you, love one another unconditionally." And so John 13:35 says, "By this," now notice this, because I believe this is astounding when you stop and really ponder it. "By this, agape, by this unconditional love, all men will know that you are my disciples." If you have unconditional love for God first, and you have unconditional love for one another second, it will prove that you are Jesus' disciples. But what does the absence of that love mean? "By this agape, this unconditional love, all men will know that you're my disciples. If you agape, love one another unconditionally." Jesus said, if you love me unconditionally, you will obey my commandments. And it's all commands. It's almost every single one. Every single one of them. Now, a few of them are family and brotherly, but almost everyone after that, the vast majority, I would say 90-95% of them are the agape, love unconditionally. Jesus said in Luke 6:32, and honestly, this is how most of us think. We love those who are good to us. And Jesus says, "Though if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you?" Right? For even sinners do that. "If you lend to those from whom you expect to receive or receive back, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners in order to receive back the same amount." But unconditionally love your enemies and do good and lend. Expect nothing in return. And your reward will be great. And you will be sons of the Most High. For he himself is kind and he is kind even to ungrateful and evil men. "Be merciful as your heavenly Father is merciful." So, why was Peter not able to match Jesus' level of love in their conversation? Peter was giving it the very best that he could at the time. There's nothing more that he really could have done in his own human effort. But he couldn't match agape because it hadn't come yet. Except for in Jesus' case. Very soon, though, in Jerusalem, everything was getting ready to change in the day of Pentecost. You see, just as Jesus had promised, the Holy Spirit was going to be sent. Even the apostles up to Pentecost had not been baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of their sins and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was not sent to indwell the disciples until Pentecost. So, once the disciples were baptized into Christ for the forgiveness of their sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit, then and only then could they fully love God unconditionally and love one another conditionally. You say, where's the proof? Where's the proof? It's thrilled me and studied. Galatians 5:22. Get this. Can you put this one up here? Okay. Praise the Lord. All right, pay attention, y'all. It's good stuff. All right, Galatians 5:22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. Not brotherly love, not family love, not all the other ones that are mentioned except for agape. The fruit of the Holy Spirit of God is unconditional love. Joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Fruit must come from a source, right? And just like with any type of tree, and fruit, the fruit of unconditional love comes directly from the Holy Spirit of God. So 1 Corinthians 13:1. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but I do not have unconditional love, I become a noisy gong, a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and I know all the mysteries of all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains and give all my possessions to the poor, and I surrender my body to the flames to be burned, and I do not have unconditional love, I gain nothing. Love, verse 4. Love, unconditional love is agape, is patient, it is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love, agape, does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, it always trusts, it always hopes, it always perseveres. I believe the scriptures are very clear on this point. Agape, unconditional love, comes only by the presence of the Holy Spirit of God. Those who do not have the Spirit of God cannot love in this degree. This kind of love is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. So Peter, by the power of the Holy Spirit living in him after Pentecost, eventually figures it out. And he writes repeatedly about agape. He writes repeatedly about this unconditional love that Jesus was calling him to. He reached his potential. He laid down his life like Jesus. Tradition says he was executed upside down on the cross. Now, the last point. Agape love comes only from God. This is the love that he's shown us. This is the love that he wants us to love him back with first, and to love our brothers and sisters in Christ with as well. And yes, even our enemies on a personal level. For God, and get this, every time we're going to use this, it's going to be agape. For God so unconditionally loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall have eternal life. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. God demonstrates his unconditional love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This is how we know what unconditional love is. How do we know? Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. And this we know and rely on the love of God has for us. God is love, and whoever lives in love, whoever lives in unconditional love, lives in God and God in them. This is also a remarkable way, through the Spirit of God, to have discernment. Love, unconditional love, does not harm its neighbor. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and unconditional love. The greatest of these is unconditional love. Be devoted to one another in unconditional love. And also, when it says be devoted to one another here, it's used agape, but also the family love is used here as well. Be devoted to one another in love. In other words, unconditional love, our family of believers, honor one another above yourselves. Dear friends, let us love, agape, one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who unconditionally loves has been born of God and knows God. And whoever does not unconditionally love does not know God, for God is unconditional love. I'm going to share something from the heart, because I believe with God's help it's time to close the chapter. I'm going to speak in generalities. We had to take a very difficult stand this past year, based upon what the scriptures say to do. It was not easy. It was gut-wrenching. But with all my heart, I believe that we did exactly what God wanted us to do. Yesterday, one of the two that were disciplined came and spoke to me. And honestly, I didn't know if I was going to get punched or a handshake or what was going to happen. But a handshake was extended to me. And we gave each other a hug. And then after that, this is what happened. The individual said, by the way, I'm going to share from the heart here. Jesus, please guide my words. The individual said, by the way, I agree with you. It is the responsibility of every pastor to try to keep their flock on the straight and narrow path.
Amen.
And I almost passed out. I was in shock. I thought, man, this is the Holy Spirit working. I don't care about me. Would I like to be loved and respected? Yes, everybody would like that. But other than that, I don't care. That's not why I'm saying this. That's not at all why I'm saying this. It's the job of every pastor to help keep their flock on the straight and narrow path. I agree with you. You did the right thing. You're a good man. Now, I'm not saying that for me. Really, truly, I'm not. That's not it. That's not it at all. Unconditional love looks different sometimes. Sometimes it's the lovey-dovey, give everybody a hug and everything feels great. And sometimes it's, hey, I love you. You're doing wrong. God wants you to do what's right. Please. Please get back in line with God's will. We love you. And both of those individuals, love was expressed, hugs were given. And in Jesus' name, with God's help, it's time to close that chapter.
Amen.
So in my mind, in my heart, it's done with. We must unconditionally love one another. When our feelings feel like it, and when our feelings don't feel like it, just like you're committed. You're committed, you know. Your feelings will come back around. But we need to love one another unconditionally, because that's how God has loved us through His Son, Jesus. Let us all love God first unconditionally. Let us all love one another unconditionally. Let us all love those who aren't like us, that are different personalities, that may even hate us. Love them unconditionally. Love builds up. Love encourages. Love protects. And guess what else love does? Love unifies. Which is where we started this message. Love for God and love for one another unifies. Let us love the Lord God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And let us love one another through the power of the Holy Spirit, unconditionally. God bless you. Thank you for being here. If you have a decision to make, come and make Jesus the one who loves you more than any, Lord of your life.
We have the nomination committee has the results.
So 49 votes were cast this year. We thank you. That means a two-third majority is 33 votes are needed. And Matt, I hate to do this in front of all your friends and family, but you made it. In fact, everybody did. So all four names that the ballot was confirmed as presented. So.
Thank you all very much. I would like to speak with the board briefly afterwards. Ideally, Lord willing, would like to do a brief ordination service at the beginning at the preaching time next week, so I want to talk more about that. And Matt and David, if you guys could hang around for a few minutes, just to explain a couple things there, too, about next week. Okay. Thank you all so much for being here. God loves you. We love you. Jason, you're up here?
Yeah.
Why don't you pray?
I'm going to volunteer. Father, thank you for such a day that you've given us that we can come here and worship you. And please be on the hearts and minds of the existing board members and these new ones as they come on board with us. Remind them that it is not their opinions, it is not their ways, it is not their wills, it is not their wants. It is your ways and your wants and your will. It's your will be done on this earth, but more specifically here in this little church with us, what we can control. I thank you for your many mercies. And this week we've needed them. And it's all. I hope that you keep us all safe and sound until the next time we are appointed to meet here. It's all these things in your son's name we pray. Amen.
God bless you all. God loves you. We love you. Have a great week, everybody.